conic section today. Okay, conic section. Conic section is a very, very big chapter, and it forms the major part of your coordinate geometry. So coordinate geometry is comprised of normally six chapters, we say. One is circles. Okay, I'll write them down. Circles, parabola, ellipse, hyperbola, pair of straight lines, and you have straight lines. That is the sixth chapter that we have already covered. Okay, so we don't have to worry about it. So these are the five chapters which are normally covered under conic section. Now, pair of straight lines is not there for your class 11. So this will be something which will be doing exclusively after your exams are done. Okay, so we'll start today with circles and parabola. Okay, they are very easy concepts. We can cover them in one class. Now, first of all, why is the name conic section given to these five geometrical figures? So let us understand that as an introduction. So let's have an introduction to conic section. So introduction to conics. Okay. Now they are called conics because these structures or these geometrical figures are obtained by intersection of a right circular double cone with a plane. Now what's the right circular double cone? Let me just show you. Just a second. Yeah. So this is a right circular double cone. As you can see, I have shown four figures. Okay. And in all the four figures, you are seeing basically a double cone structure, right? Okay. That is called a right circular double cone. Right. So a right circular double cone, first let me talk briefly about it. Let's say I make a small diagram of a right circular double cone. Yeah. Yeah. So this is a right circular double cone. Why it is called right circular? It is because the bases of these cones make a right angle with the axis of this particular right circular double cone. This is called the axis. Okay. So there are some things that you must know about them. So this is axis. These two cones basically are called the naps. Okay. They are called the naps of the right circular double cone. This meeting point is called the vertex. Okay. And these two lines, they are called the generators. Okay, so these are called the generators. Okay, so these two lines are called the generators. Now, the angle that a generator makes with the axis, this angle, whatever you want to call it, this angle alpha is basically called as the semi-vertical angle. Semi-vertical angle. Okay, now how are these conics generated? These conics are generated when a plane intersects these right circular double cone. Okay. When a plane intersects this right circular double cone, it creates a area of cross section, or you can say it creates a cross section, which can be that of a circle, ellipse, parabola, or a hyperbola. Okay. So when does it create a circle? Let us understand that. So to understand that, let's understand the figure number one over here. So figure number one shows that when this plane cuts the right circular double cone, one of the naps, in such a way that the angle that the plane makes with the axis, which is normally called as beta in this case, as you can see, this is the angle beta. So the angle which the plane makes with the axis is 90 degree. That means beta is 90 degree, then it will create a circle. So this cross-section area that you see over here, it will be that of a circle. Okay. Even if this plane passes through the vertex, it will create a point circle. Okay. A circle of radius zero. Now, when the very same plane cuts one of the naps at an angle beta, which is less than 90 degree, but still greater than the semi-vertical angle, as you can see, beta here is less than 90 degree, but still greater than the semi-vertical angle, then this cross-section area will be that of an ellipse. So figure number two shows the formation of an ellipse due to the intersection of the plane and a right circular double cone. Third diagram shows when the plane makes the same angle with the axis as the semi-vertical angle, that means beta is equal to alpha. In other words, if you see this plane direction and the generator direction are parallel. Okay, so you are slicing the right circular double cone by a plane in such a way that the angle that the plane makes is parallel to that of the generator, or the angle is equal to the semi-vertical angle. In that case, it is going to cut this cross-section area, which is that of a parabola. Okay, the pronunciation is parabola, not parabola. Okay, and like many of us are pronounced. So it is a parabola. It is not a parabola. It is a parabola. Okay, parabola is basically the path taken by an object when it is thrown under gravity. Okay, so when you throw something towards somebody, it takes a parabolic path, isn't it? That is why it's called parabola. It's a Greek alphabet, a Greek word. Now, if the plane makes an angle which is lesser than alpha but greater than equal to zero, then it will basically cut both the naps. So both the naps in this case will be cut. As of now, only one of the naps were getting cut. Now here both the naps will get cut, and you can see here the cross section generated would be called as a hyperbola. It looks very similar to a parabola, but the structure is quite different. We'll see when we do the chapter. So this is your fourth case. Okay. This is your fourth case, right? Now, if you make a plane in such a way that it is passing through the vertex of the parabola, okay, then the cross-section area will be that of a pair of straight lines. So that is a separate topic altogether, which we cover under degenerate conic. Okay, what is the word degenerate? Degenerate conics are those conics where the focus lies on the directrix. Now, what is this word focus? What is this directrix? I'm sure most of you would have heard of it, but I'm assuming that you people don't know about it right now. I'm just assuming that I'm starting this chapter very fresh and very new with you all. So we'll talk about it when the right time comes. Okay. So this is the reason why they are called conic. Now, few things you need to remember about conics. All the conics, whether you talk about circle, whether you talk about parabola, whether you talk about ellipse, whether you talk about hyperbola, whether you talk about pair of straight lines. Condition for pair of straight lines. Pair of straight lines is formed as a degenerate conic where the focus and the directrix, basically focus lie on the directrix. Okay. That becomes a case of a degenerate conic. Okay. I will talk about it, Aditya, when the right time comes. Hi, Shashwat. I have not taken the attendance. Don't worry about the attendance. Worry about what I have missed. That's the first thing you should ask. This is not a school that your attendance will determine whether you are supposed to write the exam or not. Worry about what you have missed. Okay. Attendance is no maya. Now, don't go and tell your school teacher, sir was saying attendance is more maya, so I'm not attending the classes. Okay, anyways, any conic, the equation of all conics is basically an equation which looks like this. Okay, this equation is called a general second degree equation. A general second degree equation. Do not call it as a quadratic equation. It's not a quadratic equation. Quadratic equation is in one variable. Okay. It's a general second degree equation. Okay. So it is like the skeleton of all the conics. Whether you study circle, parabola, ellipse, hyperbola, pair of straight lines, all of them, overall structure, overall skeleton would be that of a second degree equation like that. Like Homo sapiens, whether you talk about man or whether you talk about woman, whether you talk about a child, we all share the same skeleton, isn't it? Of course, there's some differences in the way our skeletons are, right? For example, for a man, the shoulders will be broader, right? Woman, the girdle will be broader. Child, the skeleton will be smaller. Okay, so overall, all the conic sections will have the same kind of equation. Here and there, A, B, H, G, F, C, etc. Oh yes, child have more, children have more bones. Very well pointed out. Why there is a 2 in some terms? Yeah, that's a very good question, Hariharan. So there are some 2 written over here. That's a question that comes every time. Sir, why 2, sir? Why not H only? Why 2G? Why not G only? Why not 2F? Why not F only? Yeah, those are very valid questions. They have been written because of certain conveniences. I'll talk about it when time comes. Okay. So remember your question, Hariharan. I'll answer this in very short time. Now, how do you distinguish then between different conics? As I told you, looking at the skeleton, how would you figure out that this was the skeleton of a man, or this was the skeleton of a woman, or this is the skeleton of an ape, or this is the skeleton of a monkey? How will you figure out? Of course, there are certain characteristics that will help us to figure out the differences. In the same way, there is certain relationship between A, H, B, G, F, and C that will help us to figure out the differences between different conics. Right? So if somebody comes and gives you a general second degree equation and says, hey, what does this represent? Then how will you figure out whether it is a circle, whether it is an ellipse, whether it is a parabola, whether it's a hyperbola, whether it's a pair of straight lines? How would you figure that out? Okay. So we'll talk about that initially, but without any proof, because as we know, we are running under time crunch. Okay. But I will definitely come back. It's my promise to you, and we'll prove all of these later on. Okay. So in order to know, in order to distinguish which conic is what, or which equation represents what conic, we first evaluate a term which we call as delta. This delta is basically formed by ABC plus 2FGH minus AF square minus BG square minus CH square. Okay, so you would be given the equation, so you would be knowing your A, H, B, G, F, C. Okay, so by using those, you find out the value of this number delta, right? Now, many people ask me, sir, why do you call delta? Because it can actually be written like a determinant. So most of you are already aware of the determinant. We had good experiences with determinants chapter earlier on. Okay. So if you expand this term, it is actually going to give you a determinant which is obtained by AHG, HBF, GFC. Okay. Now, if you see, there's an easy way to remember this. This determinant is symmetric about the leading diagonal. So you can see H here, G here, F here, F here. So that's a way to remember it. Okay. So if you just remember that there's an H, G, and F coming over here, the other elements you can automatically remember. Okay. So many people say, sir, I always forget this expression. So you can remember the determinant. Now, if this determinant happens to be, or if this delta value happens to be zero, okay, if this value comes out to be zero, yes, straight away zero, then this particular second degree equation that I have written in front of you on the top of your screen will actually be that of a pair of straight lines. Will be that of a pair of straight lines. How, why, please do not ask me right now, because there's a huge derivation involved. I promise you, I will come back to it. Okay, I'm not missing this out. Don't worry about it. But if you're still more inquisitive, you have all the videos with you of conic section, 42 videos are there. Okay, watch them, you'll come to know your answer. Okay, you'll get your answer from there. Okay, now, if delta is not zero, and if H is zero, that means there is no XY term. As you can see, H comes with XY term. So if H is zero, and if A is equal to B, and if G square plus F square minus AC is greater than or equal to zero, so you must be thinking, ayo, from where all he is getting all these things? Okay, again, take it with a pinch of salt right now. Okay, I'll definitely help you out little later on. Okay, then this would represent a real circle. Okay, a real circle is a circle whose radius is greater than or equal to zero. Okay, so there could be circles whose radius are imaginary. So we'll not talk about them actually. So we are doing real Cartesian coordinate system. So we'll not talk about non-real circles. Okay. If your delta is not equal to zero, and your h square is equal to ab, then that conic will represent a parabola. Okay, plural is parabole or parabolas. Okay, if your delta is not equal to zero and h square is less than ab, then it would represent an ellipse. It would represent an ellipse. Okay. And if delta is not equal to zero and h square is greater than ab, then it would represent a hyperbola. It would represent a hyperbola. In addition to these two characteristics, that means delta is not equal to zero and h square is greater than ab. In addition to it, if it also has a plus b equal to zero, then it would represent a rectangular hyperbola. Okay, so a special case under hyperbola is rectangular hyperbola, which we'll be taking up in our next class along with ellipse. Okay, now whatever I have done so far, most of them I have not proved it because it will take time and I'll definitely do it later on. And second thing I would like to highlight, many people ask me, sir, do we need to know equation of a right circular double cone? Do we need to know the equation of a plane? Nothing. Okay, even though two 3D figures are intersecting to create a 2D figure, we are not going to go into any of the 3D figures. Okay, it is just for you to understand why it is called a conic. In reality, you are not going to see a cone equation, you are not going to see a plane equation in these chapters. Okay, of course a plane equation is going to come, but that is in your 3D geometry chapter, not in 11th but in 12th. Okay, so don't worry you have to see cone equation or plane equation. No, we'll not talk about them. Okay, anyways, so today my agenda is to start with circles. In Hindi we call it as ayat, circles. Okay, now what's a circle? Circle, the definition, the locus definition. The locus definition of a circle is, it's a path traced by a point moving in a plane in such a way that the distance of the point from a fixed point is a constant. Okay, now not a new definition for you, and most of you would have heard of it, isn't it? So this fixed point basically is the center of the circle, and this constant is what we call as the radius, isn't it? Now, based on this locus definition, we'll be deriving the equation of a circle. So let's say this is your fixed point alpha comma beta. Okay, and there's a moving point. This is a fixed point, by the way. This is fixed. Okay, and there's a moving point P. Let's say I call it as H comma K, which moves in such a way that it always maintains a constant distance from alpha comma beta. So the path traced by P will be that of a circle. So as you can see, I have drawn a circle over here. So this will be the path traced by it. So how would I get this equation? Very simple. I can use the locus definition over here. Let me call this as C. So CP is equal to R. So CP is nothing but under root of H minus alpha whole square, K minus beta whole square is equal to R. Okay, remove the under root sign. So H minus alpha whole square, K minus beta whole square is equal to R square. Now generalize this by putting H as X and K as Y, and this will give you the equation of a circle, okay, which we call as the center. Why did I change the color? Yeah, this is called the center radius form of the equation of a circle. Center radius form of the equation of a circle. Okay, so please make a note of this. So when you know the center and when you know the radius, this is how we find the equation of a circle, and this is called the center radius form. Okay, there are a lot many forms which we are going to come across. Okay, So it's very important that we give some names to them so that when I'm referring to it, we should know what I'm talking about. Okay. And if your center happens to be, if your center happens to be 0, 0, then the equation of a circle reduces to this. Okay. This is actually named as a standard form of a circle. Watch out the names, guys. If I'm going to use it tomorrow, you should be aware what I'm talking about. Standard form. Now, why do we call it as a standard form? I'm sure you would have heard of standard forms in straight lines also, right? There were several standard forms. Two-point form, right? Slope-point form, slope-intercept form, intercept form, normal form, distance form. What were they? They were standard forms, right? Now, why we call them as a standard form? Because they are used very frequently. Something which is, you know, standard means people are using it, right? This is the standard. This is the standard size of a table, right? So because people are preferring to sit on these kind of tables only. So standard forms are the most commonly used forms. And the reason being commonly used is because they are the simplest form of that particular curve, right? They are very simple to use. They are very less complicated. Remember, a conic can be a very, you know, a big expression. The equation can be having x square, y square, xy, x, y, constant. Everything could be there, as we recently saw in the previous slide, right? But this form, as you can see, it has minimalistic thing. Okay, and that's why it becomes very simple. And so many of the properties and many of the concepts that we learn in this chapter, we basically derive them on the standard form and then extend it to a complicated form. Okay. So I normally call these standard forms like the frog in the laboratory, right? Normally, what do? In order to study the human anatomy, we cut a frog, we dissect, bisect, or whatever you want to call it on a frog, right? Because frog is easy to handle, right? We can't do it on an actual human being, isn't it? Okay. So these standard, this is the standard form. This is the center radius form. Okay. Now, please make a note of this. We are going to go do a little bit of analysis on this. Any questions so far? All right. A small analysis, a very, very small analysis. If you expand this equation, the center radius form equation, you are going to get, let me expand it here. So this equation, if you are going to expand it, you are going to get x square, y square, minus 2 alpha x minus 2 beta y plus alpha square plus beta square minus r square. I'll put them in bracket because they're all constants. Okay. Now, if you see this carefully, what is the structure of this equation? The structure of this equation is like this: x square plus y square plus 2 gx plus 2 fy. Correct? Okay. Plus a constant, because this is like a constant, isn't it? Now, somebody was asking me earlier, why do we use 2g and 2f? Okay. It's the reason because we use it is they come from squaring activity. Later on, when we do parabola, ellipse, hyperbola, there would be a squaring activity happening while you are finding their equation. And whenever a squaring activity happens on a linear expression like that, it generates that 2xy, 2gx, 2fy kind of a term. Okay. You'll get more clarity when we do the other chapters like parabola, ellipse, and hyperbola. But as of now, just to immediately satiate your question, why 2g? Because see, 2 was coming here, 2 was coming here. So we normally put the 2 in the general equation only. Okay. So that you don't have to divide by half and half. Now, this form is again named as general form. Sir, how many names are there, sir? Yeah, these all equations have different names. This is called the general form. Please note down this general form. One important thing that you must note down is in the general form, your coefficient of x square and y square are essentially 1. Okay. Now, just a quick comparison. If you remember, we had done the general second degree equation of a conic, right? What was that? Ax square, by square, 2hxy, 2gx, 2fy plus c equal to 0, right? The comparison, if you do, you would realize that in the general form, we normally keep a, b, and a, b as 1. Okay. There is no h term. You can see here. Remember, what did I tell you when I was giving those conditions? Just turn a page and check, what did I write for a circle? Delta is not zero, that is fine. There will be no h term, so h is zero. And coefficient of x square and y square, which is a and b, they will be equal. So that is what is happening over here. That is what is happening over here. Okay, right? Now, if somebody gives you the general form and they say, okay, convert it to a center radius form. Okay, or in other words, find the center and find the radius. Then you must be ready with the result. So what we are going to do next is we are going to compare this equation and this equation. Any question, anybody? Again, don't ask those questions as of now. There is a proper explanation to that delta and all. Why that figure comes, from where that figure comes. Okay, I will explain that to you, Aditya. It is a very lengthy process actually, because you have to go through pair of straight lines concept. Okay, it has a lot of significance. It has a lot of significance, but I'll come back to delta again. So let's not worry about delta right now. Okay. Yes, so Anurag, I was just talking about that this is the general form of the equation, and I'm now going to compare the equation in the general form with the equation in the center radius form. Okay, so if you compare these two, if you compare, let me write it over here, compare. Of course, x square is same, y square is same. So here, 2g is like minus 2 alpha. That means alpha is minus g. Similarly, minus 2 beta is 2f, so beta is minus f. Okay. In other words, please note down, the center is minus g minus f if the circle is given to you in the general form. Okay. So you don't have to complete the square. You don't have to complete the square in x and y to know where is the center. Directly from the general form, you can get your center. Right? Similarly, if you compare the constant c with alpha square plus beta square minus r square, you'll come to know that r square is alpha square plus beta square minus c. Okay, and alpha and beta themselves are minus g and minus f, so you can write it as g square plus f square minus c. Just take an under root, you will get the radius. So these two formulas should be here in your mind, because they will be very, very heavily used. Okay. Now, again, let's go back a couple of minutes when we started the class. When I was giving you how to identify whether a conic is a circle, there was one term which I gave you, g square plus f square minus ac. That should be greater than or equal to zero. Now, I'm sure that would be making sense to you, because if your a is one, okay, that means I have made my equation in such a way that a and b has been made one each, that g square plus f square minus ac is actually g square plus f square minus c, and it is very important for it to be positive. If not, my radius will become non-real, right? That is why it is very important for us to have that term greater than or equal to zero. Okay, Ashish, nothing very important. I just compared these two equations here. So I compared minus 2f with 2g. So g comes out, so alpha comes out to be minus g, and I compared minus 2 beta with 2f, so beta came out to be minus f. Cool. Ayo, see, everybody's internet is dying and everybody's asking, can which part you want, Anurag? I already explained this. No, which part you want? Which part you want me to explain? The whole thing. Huh, I understand that you were thrown out, but which part you want? I cannot start the chapter again, no? Kahan se batana hai, ye to batai aap. Which part? From x square plus y square. Okay, yeah. So basically I was telling the class that if you compare your equation that you have got over here by expanding the center radius form with the general form, you'll realize that your a and b are actually one in this case. Okay, your h term is not there, so h is zero, and of course the other terms remain the same. Okay, and then I said, let us compare these two equations to know how is your alpha comma beta, which is your center, related to these parameters g, f, and c. Is that fine? Do you want any more explanation? Good enough? Okay. All right. We'll just see a simple question on this. Let us say my question to you is, center and radius of, this is an example question, center and radius of this circle, 2x square plus 2y square is equal to 3x minus 5y plus 7 is equal to 3x minus 5y plus 7. I would like everybody to give it a try. I would like all of you to give me the answer on the chat box. Okay. So give me the center, give me the radius. And meanwhile, I will take the attendance. Teek, Kuram. Good, Aditya. Okay. Okay, Anurag, very good. Okay, Aritra. All right. All of you are giving me different answers. That means the concept has not been well taken. Okay. That's a failure on my part, actually. I take the blame on myself. See, first of all, there are some people who are directly using the formula. Okay. So they're saying, okay, this is your 2G term. Correct. This is your 2F term. Right. And they're saying minus G and minus F is 3/2 and minus 5/2. Okay. I think one of you have mentioned this as the answer. Please let me tell you this is wrong. Why it is wrong? Because many of you didn't bother to listen to me. This formula, when you are using, you have to have this one as the coefficient of x square and y square. If there is no one there, this formula will fail. That's what JE tests you. That's why what any question will test you on. Okay. So the first thing, as Pranav rightly said, you need to convert it to the general form. Right now, this is not a general form, my dear students. This is not the general form because there is two sitting over here. Two I don't want. So first divide by two. So when you divide by 2, this will become your equation of the circle, you know, in the general form. Now this is your general form. Okay. And on this, you are allowed to use the formula, right? So this is your 2g. This is your 2f. Okay. Please do not forget the sign. As you can see, I'm engulfing the sign along with, 2f. Okay. This is your c. Okay, so your center, as we all know, is minus g minus f. So minus g will be what? Minus g will be 3 by 4, if I'm not mistaken. Minus f will be what? Minus 5 by 4. Okay, so those who have got center as 3 by 4, minus 5 by 4, give yourself a pat on the back. You are absolutely correct. What about the radius? Radius we have already discussed, under root of g square plus f square minus c, which is under root of 3 by 4 the whole square. Minus 5 by 4 the whole square. Minus c is plus 7 by 2. Okay. Let's do some calculations over here. I think this is 9 upon 16. 25 upon 16. 25 upon 16. And this is 56 upon 16. Correct? Multiply with an 8. Okay. So that we can take the this thing. So it's root of 90 by 16. Root of 90 by 16 is 3 root 10 by 4. Okay, 3 root 10 by 4 units. Always in your exam also, please write units over here. Okay, it's not a dimensionless quantity. It has got some units. But what is the unit? In maths, we don't care about it. We care that in physics. Okay, so unfortunately, I think only few of you have got this right. Pratik has got it right. Very good, Pratik. Gayatri, Anurag has got the center correct. Okay. 45 by 4, I think it's root 45 by 8, not 45 by 4, Advik. So there is a small mistake there also. Okay. Now, going forward, I would introduce you to one more form of the equation of a circle, which is called the diametric form. Diametric form. So what is this form? This is basically a very special case when you are given with the diametrically opposite ends of a circle. Let's say I know the diametrically opposite ends of a circle as x1, y1 and x2, y2. How do I get the equation of a circle? So most of you would be thinking, so what is the need to do a new form here? I can find the center. That will give me the center. I can find the distance between the two points, half it. That will give me the radius. I will use the center radius form. Agreed. Absolutely. You can do that method as well. But there is another way to look at the things. So I can say that this circle is actually the locus of a point. Again, I'm relating it to a locus, which moves in such a way that this angle is always a right angle. So this angle is always a right angle. Correct? So I can use the fact that the slope of AP and the slope of BP and the slope of BP will be giving a product of minus 1. Isn't it? Don't we know that when two lines are perpendicular, their product of slopes is negative 1, right? So now, as a locus question, if you're looking at it, let's call this point as h, k. I hope all of you follow the proper mechanism of finding locus. Always assume the point to be h, k, okay? Till you become, a master of the game, then you can start using x and y directly. Until you, become master, you use h, k to be very, very safe. Yeah. So slope of AP will be what? Slope of AP will be K minus Y1 by H minus X1. Correct? Slope of BP will be what? K minus Y2 by H minus X2. Okay? And this product is minus 1. So let's take the denominator to the right-hand side. So this will become minus H minus X1, H minus X2. Now let's bring everything to one side. So H minus X1, H minus X2 plus K minus Y1, K minus Y2 equal to 0. Okay. Now let's generalize it. So if you generalize it, it becomes X minus X2, Y minus Y1, Y minus Y2 equal to 0. So please make a note of this because you would need this directly to solve questions. Okay. So please make a note of this concept. Okay, so this is a direct and you can say a simpler version that you can use to get the equation of a circle provided you know the diametrically opposite ends of the circle. Okay, now before I go to the other forms, I will definitely do some questions with you just to make you comfortable with the concepts. So can I go to the next slide? In case anybody wants me to stay for a while so that you can copy it, do let me know. Okay, let's take questions. A very simple question for you all to begin with. If this equation represents a circle, what do you think are the values of P and Q? Very simple, straightforward question. If this equation represents a circle, what do you think are the values of P and Q? Please respond to it on your chat box. Very good, Pranav. Good. Dear all, everybody should answer this. This is the simplest you can get. Very good. I think everybody has got it right. So what are the characteristics of a second degree equation to represent a circle? The characteristic is the first one, coefficient of x square and y square should be same. So here it is P, here it is 3. So P should be 3 undoubtedly, right? For the reason A and B should be equal, correct? Second thing is there is no xy term in an equation of a circle, right? So if you don't want an xy term to come in this equation, you have to keep your Q as 2, right? Because your H is 0 in a circle, right? So straightforward, P becomes 3, Q becomes 2. Is it okay? Any questions? Any questions, any concerns? All right, let's move on to the next one. Okay. Feel free to stop me in case you want to get an explanation for any concept. Next. Find the equation of a circle passing through the origin with 3x plus y equal to 14 and 2x plus y equal to 18 as its two diameters. Okay, so they have given you that the circle is there which is passing through origin, and the two lines mentioned to you on the question are basically acting like two of the diameters of the circle. So what could be the possible equation of the circle? I'm putting the poll on. Once you're done, put your response on the poll. I think 2 minutes is good enough a time for this. Now these are indirect questions, right? So they will never give you the center and the radius directly. It's like, you know, serving you marks. No teacher will serve you the marks for you to just grab and eat it. So they are making your life a little bit miserable. Okay, so they want you to slog a bit to get the center and get the radius and get the center radius form from there on. And of course, to convert it into a general form. Okay, so I've got a response. If anybody is not able to see the poll running, you can give your response in the chat box also. Not an issue. Come on, guys, 2 minutes about to get over. Only three people could solve in 2 minutes. Bahut na insafi hai. Okay, I can max give you 30 more seconds. Five, four, three, two, one. Cool. Okay, Pranav, no issues. I have registered your response. Okay. Only 11 people could answer this question within 2 minutes, almost 45 seconds. Okay, that's a slow speed. Okay. Is what stops you from answering this question? This is under a minute question, right? So you have been given that there is a circle, okay? There is a circle and there are two lines which are behaving as the diameters. So their intersection will give you the center, correct? And not only that, the circle is also passing through origin, okay? It doesn't have a center at origin. It is passing through origin. Don't get confused between these two, okay? So what I will do to get the center, I will simultaneously solve these two equations. Okay. Do a small thing, multiply this with 2, multiply this with 3 and subtract madi. So when you subtract, you get 15 minus 2, which is 13y, 54 minus 28, which is 26. So y is equal to 2. And if y is equal to 2, my dear friend, x has to be 4. So this center is 4, 2. So the distance of the center from the origin will give you the radius. So radius is under root of 4 square plus 2 square, which is under root of 20, correct? And now let us find out the equation, because we know the center and we know the radius by using the center radius form, correct? And if you square it up, it will become x square minus 8x plus 16, y square minus 4y plus 4 is equal to 20. So I think 4, 16 and 20 will get cancelled. It'll give you x square plus y square minus 8x minus 4y equal to 0. I think this is option number C. This has to be option number C. So people, Janta who has voted for C, oh my God, C got the most votes also. Good. Okay. So C is absolutely correct. Was it difficult? Was it worth 3 minutes? No. Okay. Let's move on to the next question. Find the center of a circle which is passing through these three points. Okay. So this is a case where there is a circle passing through three non-collinear points. Guys, remember, there cannot be one circle passing through three collinear points. It can never happen. You can never have a circle passing through three, or you cannot have a unique circle. You cannot have a unique circle, one circle passing through three collinear points. Okay. So these three points must be non-collinear, which I'm sure it is. You have to find the center of such a circle. Let's have around 2.5 minutes for this question. And the poll is on. almost 1.5 minutes, two responses. Last 30 seconds. Five, four, three, two, okay, Pranav, one, go. All right, most of you have gone with option number B, B for Bengaluru. Now, there are various ways to solve this question. One is by scamming itself, right? So you can figure out which of them is equidistant from these three points. Okay. But that would be a lengthy way because you have to find so many distance formulas. Okay. Despite that, there are many methods to solve this question. So one way is we'll first consider that let the equation of the circle itself be this. Okay. So I will say that let the circle equation itself be this. And since your circle is passing through these three points, so let me just make a quick small diagram for the same. So let's say your circle is passing through these three points. Okay. They must all satisfy this given circle. Correct. So let's put 4 and 5. So when you put 4 and 5, you get a 16 plus 25 plus 8g plus 10y, 10f plus c is equal to 0. That's your first equation. Put 3, 4, so you'll get 9 plus 16 plus 6g, 8f plus c equal to 0. That's your second equation. Put 5 and 2, you get 25 plus 4 plus 10g plus 4f plus c is equal to 0. Okay, that's your third equation. So three equations, three unknowns, g, f and c. Let's figure it out. So first of all, let me put it in a very sober way. That means let's combine the constants. So this will give you minus 41 if I'm not wrong. Okay. 6g plus 8f plus c will give you minus 25. And here 10g plus 4f plus c will give you minus 29. Okay. Now, solving this is not a Herculean task. We can just take the difference of two of them. So let's say I take the difference of the first two. I'm so sorry if I have written something incorrect over here. This is 8. So take the difference, you get 2g plus 2f is equal to minus 16. So first g plus f is equal to minus 8. That's your first equation. Okay. In fact, that's your third equation. Okay. Take the difference of these two. You get 4g minus 4f is equal to minus 4. That means g minus f is equal to minus 1. That's your fourth equation. Sorry, this is fourth, this is fifth. My bad. Okay. Now from these two, if you add them, you get g is equal to minus 9 by 2. And if g is minus 9 by 2, your f is going to be minus 7 by 2. Correct? In other words, your center will be minus g minus f. That is nothing but 9 by 2, 7 by 2. That gives you option number A as your answer. Okay, now this is one way to do it, right? Another way to do it, which you can always try it out, is assume that your center is some alpha comma beta, okay? And assume these points are PQR. So you can use that CP is equal to CQ. So So CP is equal to CQ, this will give you one equation. And CP is equal to CR, that will give you another equation. So two equations, two unknowns, alpha and beta, you can solve for it. That's another way. Yet another way is, many people prefer doing this. Many people say, sir, I will do this. I will find out the midpoint of, this is Q. I will find out the midpoint of PQ. Okay. I already know the slope of PQ. So I'll find out the equation of this particular perpendicular bisector. Similarly, I will find out the midpoint of QR. And again, I'll find out the perpendicular bisector. And these two lines, wherever they meet, that will be your center. You are most welcome to do it. But let me tell you, it will cost you some time. Okay. Constructing equations, solving them, definitely eats up your time. Okay. There is one more way which I will definitely talk about, after I have done matrices and determinants chapter with you. So there is a direct formula also, okay? Formula for equation of a circle, passing through three non-collinear points. But I don't want you to use this anywhere because number one, you're not very sure about determinants, right? You all have not, studied determinants officially, okay? And secondly, your school will not accept it, okay? Your school teachers won't accept it. You may lose marks there. So there is a 4x4 determinant, which when equated to zero will give you the equation. And that equation is x square plus y square, x, y, 1. X1 square, Y1 square, X1, Y1, 1. X2 square, Y2 square, X2, Y2, 1. And X3 square, Y3 square, X3, Y3, 1. So if you expand this determinant, okay, now many people say, sir, 4x4 determinant expanding, won't it take a lot of time? No, actually, because there is 1, 1, 1 in the fourth column. When you learn determinants, actually, there are several shortcut ways for you to expand determinants. This is just for you to note down right now. Do not use this in school. Sincere request from my side. Isko use mat karna in school. Right? If you use it, you will lose it. Okay? You will lose marks. Correct? So this 4x4 determinant equated to zero will give you the equation of the circle directly. From there, whatever you want to find out, you can find out whether it is the center, whether it is the radius, everything can be figured out from there. Okay. You can see here only the first row is made up of variables. Rest all will be made up of numbers because x1, y1, x2, y2, x3, y3 will all be numbers given to you. Okay. So this will not be a difficult thing to expand. We will talk and use this when we have learned determinants officially. Don't worry about it. Is it fine? Any questions? So I've shown you so many ways to get to the answer. Your choice, whatever method you want to use. Can you explain the ending of the first method? Ending of the first method? Yes, of course, Shashwat. What I did was I put the points and I got these three equations. I simplified it. I took the difference of the first two and the second two and I got these two equations which I have numbered as 4 and 5. Okay, sorry for this smudging over here. Then I solved it simultaneously to get my GNF. We know that center of a circle whose general equation is x square plus y square plus 2gx plus 2fy plus c equal to 0 is minus g minus f. So this is your answer. Could you show the formula at the end? Of course, yes, I will show you. This is the formula at the end. Anybody who is good with determinants or who already knows determinant, okay, can use this, okay, but only in our monthly test. Okay, yes, and one more thing I got reminded. Monthly test, even though it says full syllabus, I will only test you till wherever we cover before 31st of January. Okay, thank you. So let's move on to a few more questions. Yeah. The center of the circles of radius 5 touching this line at 1, 1 is. Read the question very carefully. Basically, they say that there is a circle and there is a line. Okay. And this circle touches this line at 1, 1. Okay. And this circle has a radius of 5 units. Now, you all can very well figure it out that there could be two such circles. Okay. That is why in your options, you can see there are two options given for every. There are two answers given for every option, isn't it? So let's solve this. 2.5 minutes will be good enough. 2.5 minutes is good enough. Time starts now. Actually, circle is a very big chapter, because if I start doing circles only, normally I'll take around 3 weeks. Okay. 3-4 classes will definitely be taken up. And I'm sure your school is not going to wait that long. So it has got almost 30 to 35 concepts. Last 30 seconds, dear all, last 30 seconds. Okay, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, go. Vote, dear all. Just 9 of you have voted. Okay. All right. So as you can see, these questions are not direct. The way you get it in school, these JEE questions are not direct. Okay. So let's find out the center. In this case, let's say our center is at H, K, right? Now, first thing I can use is the fact that the distance of H, K from this line, okay? So this line is 3x plus 4y minus 7 equal to 0. That is given to us as 5 units, correct? So instead of using distance formula of H, K with 1, 1, use the distance of point from the line. So the distance of the point from the line we know is 3h plus 4k minus 7 mod by under root of 3 square plus 4 square. Okay, this is given to us as 5. That means mod of 3h plus 4k minus 7 is equal to 25. That means 3h plus 4k minus 7 is plus minus 25. That means two possibilities arise from here. One is 3h plus 4k could be equal to 32. Or 3h plus 4k could be equal to minus 18. Okay, so these are the two possibilities. Now, I need one more equation. So what equation I can use? I can use the fact that The slope of, let's say I call this point as center and I call this point as P. The slope of CP should be negative reciprocal of the slope of this line because they're perpendicular. Slope of this line is minus 3 by 4. Negative reciprocal is 4 by 3. Correct? So slope of CP will be nothing but K minus 1 by H minus 1 is equal to 4 by 3. Let's do a cross multiplication. So you end up getting 4H minus 3K is equal to 4H minus 3K is equal to 1. Correct? Okay. Now let's solve these two. So 3H plus 4K is equal to 32 and 4H minus 3K is equal to 1. Okay. You can do one more thing. Why not test which equations satisfy it? Okay, let's check. Does 4, 5 satisfy it? Let's check. 4, 5 will give you 32, absolutely. Correct? Yes or no? And 16 minus 15 gives you 1. Yes, 4, 5 satisfies it. Okay, so obviously this is one of my answers. But till I test the other one, I cannot mark it. Because there is a none of these sitting over here. Be very, very careful. What if 4, 5 matches, minus 2, minus 3 doesn't? Then the entire option A will become wrong for us. Right? Then you have to mark none of these in that case. Getting the point? Anyways, I will now test with the other two guys. That is 3H plus 4K minus 18 and 4H minus 3K equal to 1. So does minus 2, minus 3 satisfy it? Let's check. Minus 2 gives you minus 6. Minus 12, minus 6, minus 12, minus 18, absolutely. This minus 8 plus 9 is 1, absolutely. So this also satisfies. So it has to be your option number A. Okay, so here are certain things that you can take away from this question. Many people who jump to use distance formula avoid using it. Second thing, once you have got your equations, you need not solve it always. You can test which options match those equations. Okay. Save your time wherever you can. Any questions here? Any questions? All right. So we'll move on to the next question. Next question is, tangents drawn from 1,8 to this circle touch the circle at A and B. Find the equation of the circumcircle of triangle PAB. Okay, so let me first draw a diagram for you so that everybody is fine with understanding the question. So from a point P, you are drawing two tangents to this circle. Okay, let's say this is your point P, which is 1,8. You're drawing two tangents to the circle which touch the circle at A and B. Okay. Now, what is the question setter asking you? The question setter is asking you to get the equation of a circle which circumscribes triangle PAB. So, let me just draw a circle. Oh, wow. Nice. Swalpamo. Awesome. So what is the equation of this guy? Let's have a poll running for this. Let's take 2 minutes. Time starts now. Okay, very good. IIT JEE 2008 question. Very good. Last 30 seconds. Five, four, three, two, one, go. Okay. You will be surprised to know here that this is basically based on one of the concepts you have already done in grade 10. Yes. It can be solved by a grade 10 concept. If you recall, there used to be a chapter called Construction of Circles, right? Okay. And there we used to give a question that if a circle is known, that means if you know a circle radius, sorry, a circle center, and you know a point external to it, and you have to draw two tangents to this circle. How do you construct the two tangents? How do you make these two tangents? Oh, sorry. Does anybody recall how you used to make this construction? Anybody? None. Are equal length, so how would I know what length to draw? No. What is the construction process? Tell me. Right. See, we used to find midpoint of CNP, right? You used to take an arc like this. Okay. Correct? You used to bisect this. You used to find the midpoint. Then from this midpoint, you used to make a circle like this. Correct? Do you remember? Good old days. Huh? Wherever these circles used to cut the blue circle, you used to connect P to that point. That used to be the tangent. Correct? This was what you had learned in class 10. So, what do you realize? What is the moral of the story here? The moral of the story is, this dotted circle has got P and C as the diametrically opposite ends. And it also behaves as the circumcircle for this triangle P, you can call it as A and B. Right? So the job is done, my dear friends. You have answered this question. The center of this circle, wherever it is, and this P will be the diametrically opposite ends of this blue circle. So if you know the diametrically opposite end of any circle, who can stop you from getting its equation? Let's do it. So center is what? Center is 3, 2. I hope nobody is making a mistake in finding the center at this stage. Okay? Don't ask how 3, 2. Right? So you know 1, 8 and 3, 8. You can always write down the equation in the diametric form, which is x minus x1 times y. X minus x1 times x minus x2. Plus y minus y1 times y minus y2 equal to 0. Don't write a 1 over here. There's a lot of people who write a 1 by mistake. So it's x minus 1, x minus 3, y minus 8, y minus 2 equal to 0. And your equation will come out to be x square plus y square minus 4x minus 10y plus 19 equal to 0. Option number B. It actually did not require 2 minutes also, if you are aware of this idea. Okay, and yes, I keep on saying this. Really, one day if you teach your kids, you say, never forget geometry while doing coordinate geometry. Okay, in fact, never forget geometry and trigonometry while doing coordinate geometry. Okay, all right. So with this, I'm going to now move on to another question. Next question is, a circle touches the y-axis at the point 0, 4 and cuts the axis in a chord, cuts the x-axis in a chord of length 6 units. Find the radius of the circle. Very easy question. Put your response on the chat box once you're done. And I have made a diagram for you for your convenience. By the way, there can be 4 circles. I have just drawn it in the first quadrant. There can be 2 circles. One in the first quadrant, other could be in the second quadrant as well. But anyways, we need the radius, right? Very good, Pranav. That was quick. Yeah, this is not worth 30, more than 30 seconds. Correct, Hariharan. Correct, Aditya. Nice, nice, good. Yeah, Adrija also correct. Okay. So all of you could figure out that the center of this circle would be something like h, 4 only, right? Because this should be exactly 90 degrees. That means you have to go 90 degrees from the y-axis. That means you will be parallel to the x-axis. Okay. And we know that if I drop a perpendicular, this is going to be 3, 3. Correct? And this distance is 4. Right? So anybody can figure out that the radius would be following a Pythagoras theorem. So r square is equal to 3 square plus 4 square. And very aptly said, answer is 5 units. Okay, no brainer question. I'm sure all of you would have got it. Okay, let's move on to one more. Next. If the intercepts of a variable circle on the x-axis and y-axis are 2 units and 4 units respectively, find the locus of the center of this variable circle. Okay, now let's understand this question before you pick up your pen to solve it. So there can be several circles which can leave an intercept of 2. By the way, everybody should understand the meaning of intercept here. So I would just take a small fraction of your time to tell you about intercept. See, let's say there is a circle which is positioned like this. Okay. This is your x-axis. This is your y-axis. Let me tell you, this length is what we call as the x-intercept. Okay. Let me name it AB. Okay. So AB is your x-intercept. Okay. And this length, let me call this as CD. This length is called the y-intercept. Okay. Now, variable circle means there could be so many circles which could leave the same 2 intercepts of 2 and 4 respectively on the coordinate axes. So if a circle, let's say if I can consider that the circle is actually moving or changing its dimension and its center is moving also in such a way that the intercept that it is making on the x and the y axes are respectively 2 and 4, what is the path traced by the center? So it's a locus question. And we all know that JE loves locus. Okay, so let's try to solve this question. Sir, is that a circle? I don't know. figure out from the equation. Figure out from the equation. Now you know how to identify from a second degree equation whether it's a circle, ellipse, parabola, hyperbola. So let's try to identify what is it. Okay. I'm sure many of you are not even trying because you don't know how to proceed in this question. So I'll do one thing. I'll just discuss a brief theory with you first of all. Okay. If let's say I give you a generic form of a circle, and this is a theory that you all must know also. Okay. I purposely did not cover it as a theory. I was basically waiting for this problem to come up so that we can discuss it. Aditya, just let me just take some time to explain the theory. Then you can, you know, attempt the question. So how do you find out the x-intercept value and the y-intercept value when you know the equation of a circle in the general form? Okay. So here, let us try to understand what is x-axis. X-axis is y equal to 0 line. Isn't it? X-axis is y equal to 0 line. Correct. So if you simultaneously solve these two equations, okay, let's see what do we get. So when you simultaneously solve this equation, you get an equation like this. Okay. Now this equation will have roots which will basically correspond to the x coordinate of A and x coordinate of B. So x1 and x2 will be the roots of this quadratic, which will correspond to the abscissa of A and B. Right? Now we all know that the x-intercept is mod x1 minus x2. Correct? Which is actually nothing but under root of x1 minus x2 the whole square. Which is nothing but under root x1 plus x2 the whole square minus 4x1 x2. Correct? Now you must be thinking, why am I converting it to all these strange forms? It is because if you know a quadratic and you know its roots are x1, x2, you can easily find out the sum of the roots, which is minus b by a. And you can easily find out the product of the root, which is c by a. Okay? So it'll be this, which is nothing but 2 times under root g square minus c. All of you should note down this result because it is going to be very, very heavily used in your many problems of circles. Okay. Now, why I chose a way to solve it by using quadratic equation when all I could do is use Pythagoras theorem. Of course, I forgot my own rule that never forget geometry. But I wanted to, I know everybody knows geometry, so I wanted you to know something extra. Okay. So I could also solve this question by using the fact that if the center is at h, k, let's say this is h, k, this distance is mod k. Okay. And your radius is under root g square plus f square minus c. So let's say I call this as M point, which is the midpoint of AB. So you could figure out BM length by using the Pythagoras theorem, which is g square plus f square minus c whole square, under root whole square, minus k square. So that will give you g square minus c. Okay. Oh, by the way, k here is minus, I'll write it down. K here is actually minus g minus f, right? So k here is actually mod of f, mod of minus f. So it's mod of minus f the whole square. Why mod? Because it could be negative value also. That's why we normally keep it as positive. Okay. So AB is double of BM. Okay. By the way, this is BM square. So AB is double of BM. So it'll be 2 under root of G square minus C. So both these approaches give you the same result. Okay. So this is a very commonly used result. So I would request everybody to note this down. Similarly, you could also figure out that CD, which is the y-intercept, is 2 under root of f square minus c. Okay. Now, having known this result, now you can proceed with your question. Right? So those who wanted 30 seconds, 1 minute to solve this question, go for it. But these two results should be there in your, this result should be there in your formula list wherever you are maintaining it. X-intercept. And this is your y-intercept. Let me write it down here. CD. This is your y-intercept. Sir, you forgot the spelling of intercept. Yeah. Back to the question, my dear. Right, Aritra, when you're solving this question, you should always give your answer in terms of x and y. Okay, Hariharan. Okay, Aritra, very good. Okay. Anybody who is trying, who's trying very hard? Aditya? Pranav? Pratik? Rishabh? Suraj? Rayan? Gayatri? Arjun? Abhinav? Good, good, Aditya, nice. Achha, those who have got the equation, can you also comment what kind of a curve is that? Is it a straight line? Is it a circle? Is it a parabola? Is it a hyperbola? Is it a pair of straight lines? What do you think? What kind of a curve is it? Correct, Aditya. Okay, anyways, let's discuss this. So guys, I have already done all the hard work for you. You just had to, you know, seal it off in style, okay? So what is given to us is 2 under root g square minus c is given to you. That is 2. And 2 under root f square minus c is given to you, and that is 4. Right? In other words, you have been given that g square minus c is 1. F square minus c is 4. Okay. Now, what do you want? You want the locus of the center. I want this guy locus. That means this is my x guy and this is my y guy. Okay. So I want to get a relationship between G and F. Right. So what is the role of a C? C, I don't want C beta. Right. So in order to remove C, subtract the results. Right. So you'll say F square minus G square is equal to 3. Okay. C is gone. And what next? Just replace your F with a Y. In fact, a minus Y, but this is a square. Doesn't make much of a difference. So there you go. This is the equation that you will get. And dear all, let's say I want to identify which curve is it. So let me again recall with you. This is ax square, by square, 0xy, 0x, 0f, minus 3 equal to 0. Okay. Now first delta test you will do. ABC plus 2FGH minus AF square minus BG square minus CH square. What does it come out to be? ABC, 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 ABC will be 3. Rest all of them, I think, sunya, 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 sunya. So this is not equal to 0. Right? Not equal to 0 means cannot be a pair of straight lines. Right? Now, what is the relationship between h square and ab? H square is 0. H square is 0. Ab is minus 1. Hope I am not making any mistake here. So, 0 is more than minus 1. That means h square is more than ab. Which conic satisfies delta not 0 and h square greater than ab? Go and refer to your first page of today's class. You will get the answer. In big and bold, it's a hyperbola. Actually, it's a rectangular hyperbola because a plus b is 0 also. Remember, I gave you that in addition to h square greater than ab, if it also satisfies a plus b equal to 0, it is a rectangular hyperbola. Right? We'll talk about hyperbola, rectangular hyperbola when the right time comes. Okay. Is this fine? Any kasta, any kasta. Adrija, no dear, it's a rectangular hyperbola, it's not a parabola. All right, so moving on to the last part of today's chapter. Today's circle chapter, not today's class. Okay, the last part of today's circle chapter is your parametric equation of a circle. Okay, guys, let me tell you, this chapter is huge. Okay, after parametric equation, normally I do the position of a point with respect to a circle. Then we talk about the intersection of a line with a circle. Then from there, we go to the concept of tangents, normals. Tangent also is slope form, point form, parametric form. Normal also, two types of equations are there, point form, normal form. Then we go to the concept of pair of tangents, chord of contact, the equation of a chord whose midpoint is known. Then we do the length of the tangent. Then we do the concept of pole polar. Then we do the concept of diameter, intersection of two circles, condition for orthogonality, family of circles. It's a huge chapter. It's a huge chapter, right? Sir, aankhon mein paani aa gaya, sir. I feel like crying now, sir. So, of course, we'll cover those all things, but after your school exams are over. Now, what is a parametric form? See, let me start with a very basic equation of a circle, right? By the way, what was the name of this guy? What did we call this? Pyar se? We should call it as standard form, right? Standard form. Okay, so I'll start with the standard form. And the reason I start with the standard form, because it is the most, it is the simplest equation any circle can have. Okay, no x term, no y term, just x square, y square and constant. Minimalistic. Okay, now, instead of directly relating x and y, can I relate x and y through a parameter and say x is r cos theta and y is r sine theta? Right, where theta here is a parameter. So if you eliminate this parameter, you will automatically end up getting this equation. Right, this activity you would have definitely done in trigonometry of class 10, right? So try to eliminate theta from these two. You will automatically get your equation x square plus y square is equal to r square. Okay, by the way, when you write a relation directly between x and y, they are basically referred as the Cartesian form. Okay, and of course it is the standard Cartesian form. And when you refer to it in terms of a parameter, we call this as a parametric form. Okay. Both the equations are representing the same circle. Don't get me wrong here. They're not two different circles. Same circle, but one written in Cartesian, other written in parametric form. Now, $1 million question comes from students. Sir, why do we need it? Right? I'm happy with this form. Yeah, of course, many of you are happy. Many of you, 90%, in fact, I would say 100% work is done by the use of Cartesian form in school, but not when you're solving JE main questions, not when you're solving many of the JE advanced questions. The main use of parametric form is you to choose a point on that curve. So parametric form basically gives you a hint of how to choose a point on that curve. So let's say this is my circle, x square plus y square is equal to r square. Let me draw my coordinate axes also. So if I want to choose a point on this curve, right, how will you choose a point? Let's say this is my x square plus y square is equal to 4 curve. Okay, how would you choose a point on this curve? Right, 99% of Janta will say, sir, I will choose it as x1, y1. Okay, and throughout the problem, you have to keep reminding yourself that x1, y1 should satisfy the curve. So what you have done, you have taken two level difficulty in your problem solving. One, you have introduced two unknowns, x1, y1. And secondly, you have to keep this always in your mind while solving the question. So it's an additional burden, no? Let's say if you forget this, or if you forgot that x1, y1 should also satisfy this, right? So it'll create a lot of issues in solving the problem. Instead, a smart chap, he will do this. Let me take the point to be 2 cos theta comma 2 sine theta. Now, this guy is only dealing with one unknown, that is theta. Lesser the unknown, simpler your life will be. And he doesn't have to worry whether this will satisfy the circle because it is an identity. Any theta you take, Baba, it will satisfy it, isn't it? So, working with less variables and hassle-free approach is the advantage of parametric form. Now, people ask me, sir, why not 2 sine theta, 2 cos theta? See, guys, there can be millions and billions and trillions of parametric form possible. Okay? It is not a thing written in stone that for this circle, this will be the parametric form. No. I can write hundreds of parametric forms. But this is the most convenient one. right? I can show you a few more. Let's say, what if I write it like this? X equal to t and y is equal to under root r square minus t square. T is a parameter. You tell me which is more convenient to look, which is more convenient as for you to choose a point, you will definitely say the yellow one. Because here under root n will come, no? Right? And you don't like to work with irrational quantities. Right? Yes, first one has physical significance also. I'll give you one more. What if I write x equal to, let me give you this. R by root 2 cos theta plus R by root 2 sine theta. And y is equal to r by root 2 cos theta minus r by root 2 sine theta. If you eliminate theta, trust me, you're going to get x square plus y square is equal to r square. You can try it out. But is this convenient? I say, yes, sir, you have complicated it. You have not made my life simple. You have complicated it. Right? So there can be so many parametric forms, but the preferred one is this. Okay, so you'll find it in many of the books also. Okay, and here the relevance of theta also I will show you. So basically, if you have to choose a point here, this angle actually is your parameter. So if you change that, you'll keep on getting different points on the curve. Okay, so parametric form is basically nothing but trying to connect the two variables via a third party. And it's not a new concept to you. Remember, we had done distance form in a line. That is actually a parametric form of a line. Are you getting my point? So instead of saying x and y are directly related to each other, you relate x to something, you relate y to something, and they're related in such a way that automatically their relation will become the same. It's like saying, I'll give you a very funny example. It's like saying x and y are husbands and wife. Right? Let's say they are couples. You're saying X is the father of a child theta and Y is the mother of the child theta. They will automatically become husband wife. Okay. Right. So this is what we are doing actually in this case. Is this fine? Now, if you have understood this, I would like you to suggest the parametric form for this. Suggest a parametric form for this. Suggest. I'm not saying that there's only one parametric form possible. Suggest a parametric. Anybody done? Just write done. No need to give me the answer. No need to type it out because I know writing theta and all is not a convenient thing. You have to write theta, T-H-E-T-A. Aditya has actually written it also. Aditya, are you sure? So what would be the parametric form for x square plus y square is equal to 9? That means both the curves will have the same parametric form. Same parametric form means the curve should be the same. What I want to say, Aditya, that means for you, this 1 and 3, they don't have a significance. They don't have a meaning. Or they don't will not feature in. Hariharan, absolutely. Just 1 second, guys. Somebody's at the door. Just bear with me. Yeah, sorry, somebody was at the door. Yeah. Yes, so absolutely correct, Hariharan. So what we are going to do is we are going to treat x minus 1 as 3 cos theta. So your x will become 1 plus 3 cos theta. Similarly, y plus 3, you treat it as 3 sine theta. So y will become minus 3 plus 3 sine theta. So this could be a preferred parametric form. Yes, absolutely. Yes. Okay, now, when things are written in this way, people find it very convenient. Why three? Why three here? Okay, just treat this as, Anurag, x square plus y square is equal to 3 square. How would you write the parametric form for this? You'll definitely say x is equal to 3 cos theta. Y will be equal to 3 sine theta. Isn't it? And now this x is actually small x minus 1. And this y is small y plus 3. Now you got the reason why a 3 is featuring over here? Why was an r featuring over here? You never asked me here. Why was an r featuring over here? Got it? Okay. Now, if I give this question in a general form, let's say I take another example. Suggest a parametric form for this circle, x square plus y square minus 6x minus 6x minus 8y and 5. Minus 11 equal to 0. Yeah. Now, when I give this in the general form, many people start faltering. That's why I want you to test. I want you to guys to answer this one. Suggest me a parametric form for this. Okay, see guys, you don't have to worry too much. Okay, when the equation of the circle was in the center radius form, how did you manage this? The previous example was a classic case for this. You said alpha plus r cos theta and y was beta plus r sine theta, right? Now you know that your alpha and beta are just going to become the same thing as now going to become minus g. Plus r will become g square plus f square minus c cos theta. And beta will become minus f under root of g square plus f square minus c sine theta. Isn't it? Role change. Alpha is minus g. Beta is minus f. R is under root of g square plus f square minus c. Right? So why are we not taking so much of time? So here, in this example, I can directly say x is equal to, now minus g. G here is minus 3, so minus G will be plus 3 plus under root of G square plus F square. Now let us calculate the radius first. Radius here would be under root of 3 square plus 4 square plus 11, which I had chosen in such a way that it comes out to be a perfect square. So I think 36 under root is 6. So this cos theta and Y is equal to 4 plus 6 sine theta. Okay. Now, if you try eliminating the theta from here, you will end up getting this equation. So if you eliminate your theta, you will end up getting the given equation. Okay. And vice versa question can also be asked. Vice versa question can also be asked. You may be given a parametric form and you may be asked to find out the Cartesian form. Or you may be asked to find out the center and radius of that circle. So be prepared for both types of questions. Anybody having any challenge in understanding this brief introduction about parametric form? Okay, let's seal it off with few questions and then we can go to our new topic, which is parabola. No, I don't think so, Anurag. This is going to be coming in your school. Then, sir, why are you teaching us, sir? Because you may need it in your DPPs. Okay. I'm going to just send you one DPP on circle. So you may require it there. Okay. Question is, find the parametric form of this equation. By the way, this is not a right way to frame it. You should say find a parametric form, because there can be many parametric forms. Try this out, everybody. We have just done a question a little while ago. Just say done. You don't have to give me the answer. Just say done. We are going to discuss it straight away. Five people saying done. We are going to discuss it. Done. Done. Okay, first of all, center, where is the center, my dear friends? Center is at -p/2, -p/2. What's the radius? Radius is -0, right? Which is actually p/√2, if I'm not mistaken, right? So your parametric form will be -p/2 + p/√2 cos θ. And y will be -p/2 + p/√2 sin θ. So this is one of the parametric forms possible. Is it fine? Any questions? Any concerns? Oh, sorry. It is just p. Yeah. Correct, Anurag. You are correct. Yeah. Oh, no. Sorry. So it's alpha plus r cos theta, right? Alpha was -p/2. Yeah, this is correct. Odd, Anurag, you're confusing me. Yeah. Okay. Done and dusted. Can we go on to another question? Okay, find the center, and let me add one more thing from my side, radius also for this circle. As you can see, they have mentioned this to you in a parametric form. Best thing would be to get this equation only in Cartesian form. So our center and radius will be covered under that only. So get the equation of this circle in Cartesian form. Right now, they have given to you in a parametric form. Done? Excellent. So guys and girls, I would like to bring this to your notice. Getting to a Cartesian form is as good as saying eliminate theta. That is the core principle. Whether it is a circle, whether it's a parabola, ellipse, hyperbola, or any curve in this world, if they have given to you in a parametric form and they say, get me the Cartesian form, it is akin to saying, or it is similar to saying, get rid of theta. So how will you get rid of theta? So from here I can say x + 1 = 2 cos θ. y - 3 = 2 sin θ. The best way to get rid of theta is square them and add them. Correct? No. If you square them and add them, you'll get this. Correct. This is the equation of the circle in Cartesian form. Now you can get everything you want. Center becomes -1, 3. Okay, this is your center. Radius becomes 2 units. Right, everything is answered. Fine. So with this, we will give a brief pause to this chapter. We'll come back again after your exams are done.